Bill, let's talk about business investment in Canada. What is your data telling you about the year that was?
The numbers are really awful. I guess that's the right way to start off, even though it's not a great way to start off reviewing the year. But business investment in Canada has really been struggling since the middle of the last decade. And after COVID, we all, you know, hoped and expected to see a bounce back. And of course, the numbers came off their trough. But what's very striking is, well, two things, really. One of them is the bounce back in Canada has been nothing like what it has been in the United States and in other OECD countries. And so we're seeing this big gap opening up between the rate at which we're adding to capital per worker in Canada and what's happening elsewhere, and especially in the United States, which matters to us for a whole lot of reasons. They're our closest trading partner and competitor. The other thing, though, when you look at capital per worker, which I think is a very illuminating way of expressing it. I mean, it puts it on a human scale. How often, if you're a driver, would your vehicle get replaced? If you're working in an environment with IT, how often do you get upgrades and so on? We're expanding our workforce in Canada very rapidly as a result of higher immigration and higher temporary workers as well. And what that means is that capital per worker is actually falling. It has now been falling since the middle of the last decade. That's a very troubling thing to see. There's nothing like it in our history, unless you go back to the 1930s and the Second World War. And so it raises big questions in my mind about how productive are we going to be? How are our living standards going to grow? And how competitive are we going to be?
So let's talk about how productive are we going to be? How competitive are we going to be when you take a look at next year? Of course, we're coming off of this year. We know it's been high debt, high interest rates. How does this affect spending and investing when it comes to big businesses, small businesses? What does the 2024 have in store?
Well, what the low investment figures tell you is a little bit about the environment that businesses see themselves operating in. So for whatever reason, businesses in Canada don't seem to be seeing the same opportunities or the same threats that their counterparts in the US and elsewhere are. There are many reasons why that might be. There's a bit of a virtuous or a vicious circle, because at the same time, the more you invest, kind of the more competitive threats you create for other people in your industry. And so sometimes when you see investment being low, you have to ask, like, is it because there's kind of a problem on the supply side of investment? Like, are we not saving enough? Is there not enough retained earnings? Or is it partly the incentives? But focusing first on the environment, I would say it does seem like businesses in Canada just are really not wanting to take the same kind of risks that businesses elsewhere are. Now, when you then ask, okay, what's the implication there for our productivity and growth of wages? It's pretty bleak, because I already gave the example of somebody who drives for a living. You know, if the vehicle is older, maybe not as roadworthy, maybe not as fuel efficient. If people are working with less valuable tools, less up-to-date tools in whatever line of work, then they're just not going to be able to produce as much for the same amount of effort that they would have been able to do otherwise. You mentioned interest rates. So just to cover off that side of it, one of the reasons I think why inflationary pressures are as persistent as they are, we had the big blow off at the time when the supply side of the economy was all really cramped by COVID. I mean, suddenly just a whole lot of things weren't even possible. But as we've come out of that, the fact that the Canadian economy's productive capacity is growing very quickly because of this lack of investment means that for a given amount of demand, you've just got a bit more inflationary pressure than you would have otherwise. So that means that the Bank of Canada has to keep its foot on the brake a little more than what they otherwise would have needed to do. And so we're really getting a bit of a double whammy here, where as a result of the supply side of the economy not growing in a very healthy way, the central bank has to restrain demand more just in order to keep inflation going back to 2%. If we had higher investment, I'd be a lot more cheerful about a lot of things.
Bill, tell us how, I know that you had touched on population growth. How is rapid immigration and onshoring, how is that going to contribute to growth, contribute to real GDP in 2024?
Well, if we're looking at the size of the overall economy, then the higher population is pretty straightforwardly a positive thing. But it's not the overall size of the economy that matters unless you're worried we're going to get kicked out of the G7 or something. What matters is living standards per person. In Switzerland, population growth is very slow, but capital investment is very high. And as a result, the living standards of the average Swiss person, the productivity of labor and the wages that they're earning are growing much more rapidly than they are here. So having a larger population in and of itself doesn't really make that much of a difference if your capital investment is keeping up. You can kind of think of it as like housing. When I'm talking about business investment, I'm not including residential investment, but you can think about the same kind of race between how quickly you're adding dwelling units versus the population. And if the population is growing rapidly, you just have to be adding those dwelling units. Same thing with business investment. So in the long run, I think immigration is likely to continue to do the same positive things for our economy that it has done in the past. And that is bringing in people with lots of energy and lots of ideas. And it's clearly been a driver of Canada's economic expansion in the past. What's concerning me right now is that we've got very high levels of immigration while capital investment is low. And that is a different kind of a situation. And if it means that we're going to start specializing in industries that are very labor intensive, as opposed to capital intensive, well, that takes you down a very different path of economic development from what we've done in the past and where I think we'd like to go. You don't want to be the country that's making the t-shirts. You want to be the country that's making the machines that make the t-shirts and maybe over time become the country where you design the software that runs the machines that make the t-shirts. So I don't like thinking of Canada as becoming increasingly a place where there's a lot of cheap labor and therefore we specialize in things like t-shirts. That's not where we want to go.
Let's talk about the policies, the regulation that's going to help improve that business climate going forward.
I think that there are several policy levers, and I naturally think in those terms. I mean, the CD Howe Institute is a policy workshop. And maybe just as a preamble, I'll say there are a lot of criticisms that people make about Canadian business in general. You know, maybe we're less entrepreneurial, maybe we're less good managers, have a different attitude towards risk. We have a cold climate. All those things might be true, but what you have to ask is what changed so dramatically since the mid-20-teens? And I think a couple of things jump out. First, we have a much more hostile regulatory environment towards the energy sector, particularly. It's always been a source of strength for the Canadian economy. It still is. High capital investment per worker, very high wages. It's a high productivity industry by a lot of measures. And so that has really struggled. And it's natural that people who are wondering, do I invest in Canada or do I invest in the United States? If I want to do energy production, do I want to invest somewhere else in the world? They're not looking to Canada as much. And it doesn't make sense to me that we would be restricting the production of our energy. We do, over time, want to reduce the amount of consumption of things that produce greenhouse gases. But if we can displace dirtier energy elsewhere in the world, why wouldn't we do that? So the energy sector is a big part of it. I think in general, regulatory uncertainty in Canada is quite high. It's not just energy projects that are hard to do. And we've got odd moves by the federal government, like banning plastics in all kinds of applications. Like that was a strange thing to do. And I think it just speaks to the idea that you never know quite what's coming next. A segue from that would be to the tax system. We've had arbitrary taxes put in place. The financial sector suddenly is paying extra taxes just because they were kind of unpopular at a time. We've had new taxes put on airplanes and boats and cars. We've had the federal government threatening taxes on grocers as though that would somehow make groceries cheaper. So I think that on the tax side, there's an element of this uncertainty that's a problem. And I also, and maybe I should just close on this. I mean, the list is a long one, but speaking of taxes, we had quite a tax advantage over the United States for a number of years after our tax reforms, late 90s into the 2000s. And in 2017, the United States changed its tax regime in a big, big way, and it undid a lot of those advantages. Canada is not very competitive on business taxation now. Somebody who's thinking about where to locate a head office, where to locate productive activity, is going to be looking a lot more favorably towards the United States now than used to be the case, and a lot less favorably towards Canada. So one of the things I think we could usefully do is set ourselves up for a lower corporate income tax rate over time, because a lot of countries are still lowering their corporate income tax rates, and we're getting left behind.
Bill, we have a few seconds left. Let's leave on an optimistic note. Critical minerals, EV, battery manufacturing, keeping Canada part of that equation. Give us something we can look forward to.
Well, I do think that you can look back not that far. I mean, I said since the mid-2010s, we've struggled. But over the decade and a half prior to that, Canada really raised its game. We never closed the gap in investment per worker with the United States, but we certainly narrowed it. And against other countries in the OECD, we actually did close the gap. So we've done things in the past that helped. A lot of it was on the tax side, but we're also kind of an open trading nation, and I don't like seeing some of the protectionist stuff. I think there are a lot of things that we can do by way of encouraging competition in some key sectors. And when you look in the past, you don't have to look that far back to see a time when Canada's business investment and Canada's productivity growth and wage growth were a lot healthier than they are now. So let's just absorb a few lessons from the recent past and say we can do better in the future.